So what I'm going to be looking at today is briefly, necessarily briefly, the results of our first national survey of Buddhist buildings, which ran from about 2013, 2014 to 2016, that was commissioned, as Linda said, by Historic England. So the research was in two phases. The first was about Buddhist buildings, and the second, which Emma will talk about later, focused on Hindu, Jaina, Zoroastrian and Baha'i buildings, and Emma's going to be talking about the Hindu buildings. So the overall research questions, and was talking about methodology, which underpinned our approach in both of the phases, is the questions are listed on the slides. And we were concerned, really, I think, to map where the buildings are and what they were, their histories, their current uses, and also their values and significance. And for us, in religious studies, influenced by the sociology of religion, our interest fell really on the significance and the stories and the histories that these buildings and the associated communities contain. So actually, in order to investigate these things, we employed three complementary research methods: a desk-based national mapping and information gathering, lots and lots of time spent on the internet, looking at Google Maps, looking at different websites, comparing them, which resulted in the production of databases, including information about the type or schools that the communities were connected to, types of buildings, locations, whether or not they were listed, and contact details, so that these are productive things. We did site visits, we did 15 interviews in terms of Buddhist buildings, and online surveys as well, to try and capture as much information as we can within the remits and the logistics of the project. I think what's important to note from the start, and other people have alluded to this, is that these communities, but also Buddhism in Britain particularly, is marked by diversity. So according to the 2011 census, there are 238,626 Buddhists living in England and Wales. And you can see this in comparison to the other communities of our projects that we studied. And actually what's significant about this is that compared to the 2001 census of England and Wales, where there were 144,000 approximately, we see a 100,000 person increase over that 10-year period. And so whilst Anglican affiliation may well be on the decline, Buddhism as a religion is on the increase. So the diversity needs to be, we need to dig more deeply into the diversity, because Buddhists in Britain are both converts and those born into Buddhist families. They're drawn from different ethnic groups. About 35%, this is quite unusual about the Buddhists, about 35% of them are white British, and we assume from convert families, either converted themselves or their parents. But others include Sri Lankan, Vietnamese, Burmese, Chinese, Taiwanese, Thai. Okay, so the demographic increase in the census partly relates to immigration, but also towards the establishment of a type of homegrown Buddhism, which has its history in colonial and imperialist connections and interests. So what this diversity means is that under the rubric of Buddhism, there's a range of teaching, teachers, styles, practices, approaches, and indeed they're not just one community. Some will have very little connection with others. They'll have little knowledge of each other. In fact, when we were doing this research project, the community themselves were saying, gosh, this is really an interesting thing. I had no idea they were down the road, or I had no idea this existed. Okay, so this is not a coherent community necessarily. And so this has an effect on the type and the style of buildings that we'll see in this context, that you'll see throughout what I'm talking about. Okay, so I quite like tables, so forgive me. Over the course of our research, we identified 189, so Linda, you're right, 189 Buddhist buildings in England, and I'd say this is growing even now. So the problem with coming up with these lists is that new buildings are built all the time. In fact, I'm going to see one in Leeds next week. So this is growing even now as more temples, centres, spaces are being established. So, you know, this is a snapshot in time rather than the end point. So to the best of our knowledge, this is the total, at the time, the total amount of buildings that were owned or rented long term. We've not counted all the Buddhist groups that might meet, particularly there's a particular affinity between Quakers and Buddhists in this country, the Buddhist groups that might meet within Quaker meeting houses or in people's houses or rent rooms elsewhere. We've actually talked about public-facing buildings, okay? And this would be a much, much larger number. So the key points to note from these numbers is the highest number of buildings in England are in the Tibetan traditions. These are increasing in popularity, and particularly one Tibetan group, the New Kadampa tradition, one of the three largest Buddhist groups in England, with buildings in almost every city and town. And there are more suburban buildings than any other style. This kind of reflects a number of things. One, the availability of space and the cost of buying urban or rural buildings and maintaining them, and a desire for some Buddhist groups to be near where particular communities are living. And this is a slightly different picture. It would be a slightly different picture for Wales or for Scotland, where there'd be more rural retreat-type centres. Okay, and actually a number of Buddhist communities in England have also retreat centres in more rural areas. So 23, about 12% of our total here, are within listed buildings. And this is really interesting. These have particular issues to face, both in purchasing and adapting the buildings, but also in maintaining them. But what we have found, and what I really strongly want to get across, is the great benefit, really, to our heritage of these communities that are taking over these buildings, renovating them to both expense and effort, and then opening them up to the public, taking buildings off the at-risk register commonly, and opening them out to public use. Interestingly, I suppose that many of these buildings are in the south of England. And this is to do with patterns of migration and wealth, but actually buildings elsewhere are now increasing. So I think it's really important to say that most Buddhists in Britain and beyond generally have space to practice at home, and some have dedicated shrine and meditation rooms that they'll use individually or with other people. But many go outside their homes to practice, both for religious or spiritual practice and cultural activities. It's very difficult, almost impossible to separate those two. And indeed, the buildings are an important site for community gathering, cultural transmission, and spiritual learning, teaching, and practice. The buildings that are used by Buddhists in England have a range of functions, including particular parts of practice, which here, particularly in the UK context, is communal or individual meditation, chanting or attending Dhamma talks, the teaching of the Buddha, and the celebration, particularly of Buddhist festivals, and also a location where cultural community activities for Buddhists are carried out. This is sacred space. And I think the celebration of festivals, the community activities, particularly around sharing of language, is particularly important for diaspora Buddhist communities from Thailand, Cambodia, Sri Lanka, Burma, Vietnam, Taiwan, and often involves activities in local languages reflecting certain particular local customs and traditions. And buildings in this context are also an important place for Buddhist monastics and other ordained persons to live, including those from a Western convert background as well as those from diaspora backgrounds, and as a place for lay Buddhist communities to live together in a communal setting, which is particularly popular within the Tri Ratna Buddhist movement, another Buddhist group who's one of the three largest in this context. So a number of Buddhist buildings function as spaces where retreats and courses are offered, including to the wider public, and this has been increasingly the case with the rise of mindfulness across this context, in the way that Buddhist organisations are working in a secular mindfulness type way. But there are also two Buddhist schools for young people, one in Derbyshire and one in Brighton. Okay, so this is another increasing pattern. And we also found places where Buddhist businesses were established Buddhist ethical principles can be lived out through those businesses. Charity shops, world peace cafes, bookshops, and like I said, the spaces where mindfulness meditation can be marketed to Buddhists and non-Buddhists, sometimes increasingly so by referral from health professionals and working in collaboration with the NHS. And so finally, a number of the buildings also offer spaces that other groups, Buddhists or not, can hire for events and workshops, although this was more prevalent amongst those buildings that are typically operated by convert-dominant groups. In fact, really just from, I've selected four photos just for this slide, and just from looking at that, you can see a picture of diversity. And you can see throughout the slides a picture of diversity. So this is Milton Keynes Peace Pagoda, the first Peace Pagoda built in Milton Keynes there. To Taplow Court, which is here, which is the home of the Lay Soccer Gakkai International Group. To the London Fo Wen Shan Temple, which is in Oxford, Oxford Movement Training Facility, Clergy Training Facility. To the Jamyan Buddhist Centre here, which is again in London, in South London, which was a former Victorian courthouse, which they renovated, that used to house, you know, in the latter lives of the courthouse, used to house IRA prisoners awaiting trial, and a wonderful story of the renovation where that's the Gompa, the main shrine room, where the judge used to sit. They had to remove the bulletproof glass in order to replace him by a statue of the Buddha, where they were. You can go and stay in this Buddhist centre now. The former cell rooms are now hotel accommodation, you know, for people visiting, where they removed the radiators to replace them and sympathetically replace them. They found notes from prisoners tucked behind the radiators. And these things have all been kept in archives, with the Buddhist centres kind of maintaining both what is the essential fabric and the social history of the building with the new Buddhist functions and community too. So they just tell these wonderful stories, what wonderful social histories. Okay. So throughout the research that we've done, we discovered, you know, perhaps unsurprisingly for a diverse group, Buddhist communities choose a range of buildings to suit their budget, needs, and aspirations and current situations. And these range from former domestic houses, or what we've called semi-detached temples, through to adapted, sometimes taken from listed or at-risk registers, adapted buildings, through to purpose-built temples. For example, Wat Buddhapadipa in Wimbledon. And also to converted rural buildings as retreat centres and monasteries. Okay, so a real range of types. So it almost becomes so hard to keep these all just in one typology, right? And so we found to a certain extent that communities progressed through different building types as they became established. You know, you begin meeting in somebody's front room, your rented building, you move to a semi-detached temple, you might want to convert something, then when you've built up enough social capital and economic capital, you can then think about purpose building something that more precisely fits your needs and aesthetic. But actually it's not necessarily a linear progression. There are some changes to building use as communities grow, as they've become more established, and certainly we do predict that there will be more, that purpose-built temples will be more of a feature on the landscape as we progress, and indeed that they are now, as communities grow and develop. And indeed, in many ways, as they become more confident in articulating what they want in terms of sacred space. So it's partly about a confidence as well, a familiarity with what they could possibly do, and a confidence in their own ability to take up space. So in the interviews, we investigated in more depth why particular buildings were chosen by specific communities. And a number of groups chose to purchase and adapt large public buildings. Okay, this is one of them in this Manchester Buddhist Centre. So this was in a former cotton warehouse in the Manchester's northern quarter. So actually a larger building is seen as desirable for advantageous for Buddhist practice because they often give a large hall or a space for communal meditation. And indeed, it's the communal meditation, the communal gathering that's prioritised. So having a large central space in a former school or a former church, you know, these things are really significant. They translate naturally into a good use, a sensible use for Buddhist communities. So because meeting together, sharing Dhamma talks, being communal is a key function of Buddhist buildings in this context. But indeed, for many, cost is the primary consideration on the decision to select a particular building to occupy, and indeed expertise and skills. Because if you have to raise funds to purchase buildings, some of the buildings will have been supported transnationally in different contexts, in Thailand, for example, but not many are. Most of these are home-grown, home-raised money amongst the people for which the buildings will be used. But if you need to do all of that stuff, and the renovation, the ongoing maintenance and renovation of big buildings, the attention to cost and what you might need is also a significant factor. And indeed, whilst I said the renovation work is wonderful in terms of the maintaining of public spaces at risk buildings, and in many ways the Buddhist communities that we went out to were very sympathetic, very, very concerned. Some had worked closely with Historic England, and very concerned to maintain the essential fabric of the building as well as using it. Actually, the renovation work is very rarely easy. And I want to emphasise the labour of love that this takes. For many of the Buddhist communities, and I can talk about Manchester Buddhist Centre, it is a particular example of this. It's learning what to do with the limitations of volunteer labour. It's living in bitter conditions to get these buildings finished. It's sleeping in spaces with have no window glass in midwinter. It's living in caravans with no running water in order to be on site to facilitate these buildings. These are a labour of love. You know, I want us to get that sense that this isn't somehow divorced from a very strong desire amongst many of these communities to get these buildings off the ground and personal sacrifices to do so. And indeed, there are a number of long-term issues in terms of ongoing maintenance, particularly for those in adapted and listed buildings, but also for those in purpose-built temples. Some of the difficulties, for example, in Wat Buddhapadipa's case, of having an architecturally perfect Thai Buddhist temple built in Wimbledon, difficult in terms of using the roof tiles that are used in Thailand that are okay in the hot weather, but not necessarily okay in the cold weather, having the marble surrounding the shrine room, it becomes like an ice rink in the winter, fine in the hot, wet, really not fine in the winter. You know, there are a number of ongoing issues that are in the adaptation and the purpose building of places. And it is a live issue for Buddhist communities across the country. So with the growing number of Buddhist communities becoming established, there'll be an increasing number of buildings making up our religious landscape. And it's exciting to talk about this to you today, because this is and will continue to be a significant feature of our religious landscape and our social landscape. They're diverse in terms of use and style, but having a sacred and community space remains vital for Buddhists in the UK, as it does elsewhere. I think I stuck to time as well, which is nothing short of a miracle for me.